to First Baptist Church. I guess I am the substitute today. So for announcements this morning, I am not aware of any special announcements. We have our normal Sunday activities today. Obviously, Pastor is not here. Pastor and Laura are traveling, bringing Alethea to college, so you can pray for them as they travel out east and travel back again. They are planning on being here next Sunday, Lord willing, they'll be back. And next Sunday also we have a special service for baptisms, and we have three and possibly four who will be baptized next Sunday, so please join us for that. That will be a real time of blessing as we witness these young believers who are giving their testimony of their faith in Christ. We also have Bass Lake Camp coming up, the men's retreat, still in September 6th and 7th. And then very quickly, Kids for Truth is starting once again on Wednesday, September 11th. So please keep that in your prayers if you're able to help out. I'm sure Mike and Sharon would love to have some volunteers, so you can always speak with them about that. And then we have the MARVC annual meeting is going to be here the following week, September 16th through the 18th, starting Monday evening and finishing Wednesday morning, if you're able to attend. And if you're able to assist, I think you can. It's just safe to say you can talk to Cindy. That would be just safe. If you'd like to help out, especially on Tuesday. So I believe that's all the announcements we have for today. So if you wouldn't mind, we will stand and sing together. We gather together to ask the Lord's blessings.
Have a word of prayer. Our Father, again, we do indeed thank you for this day and the opportunity we have to gather in your name. And we just pray today, the Lord, that as we lift our voices to you, as we be around your word, Lord, that you speak to our hearts. And Lord, that we, as we lift our voices to you, Lord, that it'll be a blessing to one another and to you. Lord, we think of some in our church this morning. We thank of Raleigh. We thank you for bringing him and Ruth this morning, and just for the surgery going well with him. We just pray you continue to be with him as he heals and just give him strength, Lord, each day, Lord, and to help him to get back to good strength. Lord, we think of Lois this morning, again, dealing with some problems. And Lord, we just pray that you just help her to have strength each day, and just help Daryl as he comes along her side and does what he can to help her to heal. So we just pray, just bless there. Lord, we think of Pastor this morning, Laura and Alethea. We just pray that you be with them on this trip they're on and give them safety. And Lord, that things would go well there, and they would be able to get her dropped off for college. And Lord, that be a good start for her in her college days. We just pray you just guide there, bring them back here safely. Be with the rest of the family, Lord, that's their home. And just watch over them, meet their needs, Lord, at home. Lord, we again think of the annual meeting that's coming up. We just pray with for those, Lord, who are working with that and planning that, doing different things, that, Lord, things would be all coming together for that. That would be able to happen and be a blessing. Lord, we just pray you just guide there. Think of this trip coming up to Canada for this little work week to help out at the camp. And we just pray that the plans will come together there this week later on, that we'd be able to get things set for that. Lord, that you'd just be able to bless that trip. Just have your hand in that. Lord, we think of those, Lord, that aren't with us this morning for one reason or another. We just pray you just bless them where they are. Help them to be able to be around your word, and possibly some singing in one form or another. We just pray that you just bless. But thank you for each one here this morning. And trust we've come this morning with hearts ready to hear what you have for us this day here. And we pray that you be with Eric as Lord, he delivers the message you've given him. Just use it in our hearts. Again, we just give you praise and thanks for your love and your goodness to us and your many blessings. We thank you in Christ's name. Amen. Psalm 150. Praise the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in his mighty heavens. Praise him for his mighty deeds. Praise him according to his excellent greatness. Praise him with trumpet sound. Praise him with lute and harp. Praise him with tambourine and dance. Praise him with strings and pipe. Praise him with sounding cymbals. Praise him with loud clashing cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
We're going to sing now, Crown Him with Many Crowns.
Thank you. Jonah 3, verses 1 through 10. Then the word of the Lord came to Jonah the second time, saying, "Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and call out against it the message that I tell you." So Jonah arose and went to Nineveh, according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceedingly great city, 3 days' journey in breadth. Jonah began to go into the city, going a day's journey, and he called out, "Yet 40 days, and Nineveh shall be overthrown." And the people of Nineveh believed God. They called for a fast and put on sackcloth, from the greatest of them to the least of them. The word reached the king of Nineveh, and he arose from his throne, removed his robe, covered himself with sackcloth, and sat in ashes. And he issued a proclamation and published through Nineveh, "By the decree of the king and his nobles, let neither man nor beast, herd nor flock, taste anything. Let them not feed or drink water, but let man and beast be covered with sackcloth, and let them call out mightily to God. Let everyone turn from his evil way and from the violence that is in his hands. Who knows? God may turn and relent and turn from his fierce anger so that we may not perish." When God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil way, God relented on the disaster that he had said he would do to them, and he did not do it.
Temple, he asked to receive alms. And Peter directed his gaze at him, as did John, and said, "Look at us." And he fixed his attention on them, expecting to receive something from them. But Peter said, "I have no silver or gold, but what I do have I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." And he took him by the right hand and raised him up. And immediately his feet and ankles were made strong, And he leaped up and stood and began to walk and entered the temple with them, walking and leaping and praising God. And all the people saw him walking and praising God and recognized him as one who sat at the beautiful gate of the temple asking for alms. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to him.
Stand as we sing our last hymn this morning, God Moves in a Mysterious Way. And my understanding is this might be new to someone, so I've asked Judy if she would go through the whole hymn first, and then we'll pick up.
The microphone. I always say when I'm filling in for a pastor that my job is to make you miss your pastor. I miss him already. That last hymn, I don't know if it was new to you or not, is a great hymn. I like that hymn very much. It reminds us that we don't understand God's ways. His ways are higher than our ways. His thoughts are higher than our thoughts. And we are tempted sometimes to question God's ways in the world, in our lives. And the hymn reminds us that that's not always the wisest thing to do. But we have to trust that our God is a good God. And what he is doing in our lives, what he's doing in the world, is good and for his glory. So I hope you enjoyed that and were able to think about that. As I mentioned before, Pastor and Laura are away. This Sunday, bringing Alethea to college. They will come back later this week, and then Pastor will turn around and bring Joseph to college, Lord willing. And Pastor's plan is to be here next Sunday. Like I said, we always, as James tells us, say that as the Lord wills, we will do this or that. So that is the plan, and we can pray for that. I'll be speaking again from Galatians 4, as I did a couple weeks ago. And we'll actually I'll be preaching from Galatians 4, verses 8 through 11. The Olympics, as you know, just concluded. And I don't know if you follow the Olympics. I wasn't able to really follow them much this year. But what we see at the Olympics is a lifetime of preparation on the part of the athletes. And when you look at what these athletes accomplish, it is phenomenal. In fact, on the internet, there were people making little videos about why they did not make it to the Olympics. Those were pretty comical, too. But we watch the Olympics and we think, oh, I can do that. Well, we can't do that. Every one of us in here is too old to start if we wanted to make it to the Olympics. Yes, even you, John. Sorry. One of the Olympic athletes in particular, American Ryan Krauser, won his third gold medal in the shot put. And the shot put is a 16-pound ball. It's about the size of a softball, so it's very heavy, very dense. And he pitched it over 75 feet. And he is also the world record holder of pitching it, I think, over 76 feet, this 16-pound softball. Someone was interviewing him and asking him about, well, you know, he's over 300 pounds. He said, you cannot be an Olympic shot putter if you're under 300 pounds. So some of us men in here, we've got a shot at that. But he's like, you know, you got to be 300 pounds. But he was beginning to talk about his training. He's like, oh yeah, well, everyone thinks about weightlifting because you're pushing this shot put. He goes, but we have to study sprinting. He says, we practice sprinting. He says, we practice weightlifting. Because we twist, he said, we also do a lot of exercises like a baseball player does who's swinging a bat. He said, every single muscle, I train every single muscle in my body so that they all work in harmony to throw that shot put even farther. And he says, I think I can throw it farther still. This is a person who's got his mind completely focused on what he is after, what he is pursuing. And he understands the physics behind it, the biology behind it, the mechanics of his own body behind it. And he said even the mental, you know, preparedness for going into a meet. He said everything is working towards that one end. And in fact, there's a proverb that Jesus quotes in the New Testament that says that a person who puts his hand to the plow and looks backwards is of no value, is of no good. In fact, Jesus says that person cannot see the kingdom of heaven. Because once you grab hold of that plow, you can only go forwards, because that's the direction it's moving. But if you're going to make a straight line, you can always only look to the end of the row to make sure that your row is straight. That's the only place your gaze can be. And Paul uses an analogy here. He uses a phrase in Galatians 4, which I've entitled here, no turning back. There's no going back. Once you are a Christian, Paul says, there is no going back. There's no turning around. I'd like us to read Galatians chapter 4, and we'll read verses 8 through 20 to get the broader context. And like I mentioned, we'll speak from Galatians 8 through 11. or chapter 4, verses 8 through 11. So Galatians 4, starting in verse 8. Formerly, when you did not know God, you were enslaved to those that by nature are not gods. But now that you have come to know God, or rather to be known by God, how can you turn back again to the weak and worthless elementary principles of the world, whose slaves you want to be once more? You observe days and months and seasons and years. I am afraid that I have labored over you in vain. Brothers, I entreat you, become as I am, for I also have become as you are. You did me no wrong. You know it was because of a bodily ailment that I preached the gospel to you at first. And though my condition was a trial to you, you did not scorn or despise me, but received me as an angel of God, as Christ Jesus. What then has become of the blessing you felt? For I testify to you that if possible, you would have gouged out your eyes and given them to me. Have I then become your enemy by telling you the truth? They make much of you, but for no good purpose. They want to shut you out that they may make much of you, that you may make much of them. It is always good to be made much of for a good purpose, and not only when I am present with you, my little children, for whom I am again in the anguish of childbirth until Christ is formed in you. I wish I could be present with you now and change my tone, for I am perplexed about you. So the question I would like us to ask ourselves this morning is, have you turned back, or are you pressing forward? Let us pray. Our Father, we are grateful that we can gather together in your house, that we can read the scriptures, that we can sing hymns of praise to our Savior. Father, we pray that you would give us wisdom as we search out your word now, that we would that the Holy Spirit would make it known to us, that if necessary, he would convict us of sin, and Father, that we would seek to change our hearts and our minds to be like that of Christ. We pray that you would instruct us from your word, and we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So you might recall that Paul, one of the reasons that Paul is preaching or is writing the book of Galatians is to defend the one true gospel. He has stated this right from the very beginning of the book. He preached the gospel to the Galatians. They were saved. Churches were formed. And immediately after Paul leaves, false teachers come in and say, Paul didn't teach you the right gospel. Let us teach you the real truth. And they were confused by this, so they wrote Paul immediately and said, hey, this is what they're telling us. We have to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and we have to do these things. We have to practice certain Jewish traditions. One of them is mentioned in this passage, keeping days and weeks and months. Those are Jewish traditions. You have to do these things also in order to be saved. And Paul says, did you not believe me when I was there? Like, how quickly have you been turned aside from the truth? So Paul is emphasizing through most of the book the true gospel that we have, the true good news that we have in our Lord Jesus Christ. And I want to review this briefly because it's the main point that Paul is making here. The main point is this is the gospel. And really, I'm going to use a little method here, but if I can encourage you, there really should be, you should be able to, if someone were to ask, what's the gospel? What is this good news about Jesus Christ? Really, you should be able to, within 30 seconds or a minute, give a brief outline. And you say, because it's good practice. Well, it really is good practice, but I've actually had this happen to me as well. I had a coworker once spin around and just say, Eric, can you explain this Jesus thing to me? Okay. Sometimes you have to give the elevator speech, as we call it sometimes. But, so here we go. I'm going to give the elevator speech. Number one, God is a holy God. That's where we start. God is a holy God.